Now this morning we're going to continue on our teachings, the Setter of El Elyon. The Setter of El Elyon. I want you to come with me to Luke's Gospel chapter 15, please. And I told you something yesterday that I'm going to repeat again. For maximum effect, you must stay long enough in the secret place to create a memory. Why? Because everything else can be robbed. But Satan cannot steal your memories. In fact, that was the secret revealed in the sensational return of the prodigal to his father's house. Look at verse 17 in Luke's Gospel chapter 15. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. His money was wasted. His friends were gone. Financially broke, destitute, in a strange country. The only explanation we have of that place is a far country. Far away from where you ought to be. Far away from plenty. I want you to write these things down. You're coming here to let the word change you, not to remain the same way you were before you heard the word of God. There must be change. There must be transformation. There must be a difference. So where there was plenty, now the word want begins to feature. Self-confidence shattered, leaving everything behind him. This man is sent to do what he did not like to do. He was forced to go into the field to work. If this man was a worker, he would have been working with his elder brother. Can I have an amen, please? You look at people who are lazy, they're plain stupid. They don't understand the purpose behind which God says, I will bless the labor of your hands. He didn't say, I'll bless your hands. The word labor never features in their life. So they refuse to labor. Everybody else is laboring. They refuse to go out into the field to work. So they have time to be focusing on someone else's money, someone else's wealth. What was the one thing that brought this fellow back to his senses? Have you ever thought about it? Not the pig. Work. And that's why in any good rehab program all over the world, one of the many things that they will give the ones who are going through rehabilitation, whether it is for mental disorders or whether it is for someone coming out of alcoholism or any kind of abuse, is systematic, disciplined work. So when you systematically work, the good memories begin to come up. Not once did this fellow say, where are my friends? I gave them so much. Why can't they give me? No. His mind went back to the father's house. He was made to do what he detested doing, which was work. Hunger ruled his actions as he tried to eat husks given to swine. Everything lost except one thing. Memory about the father's house. Why? Because in the father's house, there was abundance, superabundance. Not just abundance for the son. Now listen, this boy never even said, my elder brother has everything. He said, hired servants have in excess. And I just want you to write it just like I'm saying it. Household servants in a Jewish house were like family members. Hired servants were always treated differently. Even they had in excess. Memories of a house where his father dwelt and plenty experienced by all began to flood the man. Please write this down. Memory is the miracle magnet that attracts you back to your father's house. Miracle magnet. Memory is the gift of God linking you to your restoration. Memory is the catalyst for repentance. You will only return to a place of pleasure and not to a place of pain. Therefore, you must stay long enough in the secret place to create a memory of pleasure, change, and strength. You can't just breeze in and breeze out. You can't say, I just didn't have the time, so I just whispered a prayer. You better find your time. Make time. There is no excuse. Make time. Staying long enough is making time. I want to quote what a journalist said yesterday when he was being interviewed and asked about the assassination that took place. Someone was asking him something about Benazir Bhutto. And this is increasingly coming out on television, and that's why I want the church to pay attention to these words. He said, the family is cursed. Unbelievers are beginning to come out and identify if there is a cycle of something happening, it's called not blessing, curse. And this word is, for the last couple of days I've been hearing it from different journalists for used for different conditions. And identifying a systematic chain of events that does not pertain to natural, everyday occurrences. It is out of the ordinary. And they're saying it openly on television. Journalists are talking about the curse now. Then why can't preachers talk about the blessing and the curse? For years, people thought it was all a big mumbo jumbo. Some Pentecostal preacher is just yakking off on blessing and curses. No, it's very real. Life and death is very real. Blessing and cursing is very real. The power to choose lies with us. I said the power to choose lies with us. If you leave your secret place too soon, before the Holy Spirit talks to you, you may become reluctant to return. Because to you, the Holy Spirit will become a person who never speaks. Years ago, I read about Pastor Paul Yonggicho, who would later be called David Yonggicho, the one who pastors one of the biggest churches, mega churches in the world, in Seoul, Korea. He said, every day I've got to pray 5 hours. Someone asked him, why can't you cut short the time? He said, no. Just can't cut short the time. Because I need to spend long time with the Lord to hear from Him. Sometimes after I worshipped and I've prayed, I've got to spend time sitting in His presence to hear from Him. Because only after I've heard from Him, the next thing can be done. And out of this kind of an heavenly and divinely planned secret place, people were encouraged, and still do, when they travel to Seoul, Korea. They go to the prayer mountain there. And they take days off, sometimes 21 days, sometimes 7 days, sometimes 40 days, sometimes 3 days. And they spend time before the Lord praying. So around the clock, at any given time, there are 3,000, 4,000 people praying all the time, all the time. People will hear of this and say, then why don't you start a prayer chain? Well, prayer chains don't save anybody. Staying long enough in His presence does. There's no use in prayer chains. Sometimes prayer chains become useless after a point of time. People start giving excuses for not wanting to pray. Why? Because they have not spent time long enough to let the Holy Ghost talk back to them. They're all fervor the first 3 weeks. Fourth week, no prayer. But all of a sudden, during the prayer time, only some work cropped up. My friends, if you have an appointment with God, you will not let anything crop up at that time. How long should you stay? To create a memory of pleasure, change, and strength. 2 minutes, Bible reading. 3 minutes, prayer. Quarter second, worship. You won't get the job done. You may satisfy yourself, you prayed for the day. You won't get the job done. Some will say, well, these things help preachers. But what about laymen? We're talking about laymen. I'm talking about laymen praying. It's not the preachers who are going to prayer mountain. It's laymen and women going to prayer mountain. Some say, well, they must be awfully wrong. What are they doing? Is it a pilgrimage center? No, it's not a pilgrimage center. They've heard from God. People who go on pilgrimages don't hear from God. They just go in religious fervor. But when you hear from God, you go with a sense of expectancy because you know there is divine appointment. If you are coming here on a pilgrimage, you would come, kiss the door, and then get back. You'd be very happy. I went to church. But if you came here knowing that I would be here, then the moment you don't see my face, you'll want to know, where's Pastor? That's how prayer is. Where are you, Lord? You read any good book, the most popular right now, you know, that you can see on this is Good Morning, Holy Spirit. You cannot get tired of reading that book, really. If you're stumbling across the title, then don't read the title, just enter the book. Some stumble so much on the title of the book that they never get to read what's inside the book. Read what's inside the book. Find out how your prayer life can change. Because if you leave too soon before the Holy Spirit talks to you, you may become reluctant to return. How long should you stay? Now that's what we're going to be dealing with from now on. Till now was introduction. Number one, the answer to that is, you stay long enough to receive His command. You stay long enough to receive His command. Come with me to Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy. And I'm going to show you a couple of things, please. I want you to have your Bibles, pen, paper ready. Come with me first to Deuteronomy chapter 5. We're going to read a couple of scriptures out. Don't get tired of reading the Bible, because the more you read the word, the more firmly ingrained every statement you hear becomes to you in your spirit. Deuteronomy chapter 5, and look at verse 22. These words the Lord spake unto all your assembly in the mount out of the midst of the fire, of the cloud and of the thick darkness with a great voice, and he added no more. Mark that down. And he wrote them in two tables of stone and delivered them unto me. Can you believe that? God writes down what he says. And it came to pass when you heard the voice out of the midst of the darkness, for the mountain did burn with fire, that you came near unto me, even all the heads of your tribes and your elders, and you said, behold, the Lord our God hath shown us his glory and his greatness, and we have heard his voice out of the midst of the fire. We have seen this day that God did talk with man, and he liveth. Mark that down. God talks. They were creating a memory of one thing. God talks. He's not an idol. Not an idol. When they forget God, the first thing they do is go after idols. How does God bring them back to their senses? He says they have eyes, cannot see. Ears, cannot hear. Mouth, cannot speak. But me, I'm the God of Abraham. I spoke to Abraham. I'm the God of Isaac. Spoke to Isaac. I'm the God of Jacob. I spoke to Jacob. He brings back memories of a God who speaks. Now therefore, why should we die? For this great fire will consume us. If we hear the voice of the Lord our God anymore, then we shall die. No one said that they would die. But these people were so death-oriented that they never thought of life. God wanted them killed, you to kill them first. Why talk to them? Why waste time talking to them? But this is what they came and said to Moses. For who is there of all flesh that had heard the voice of the living God speaking out of the midst of the fire as we have and lived? So why think of death? But this is what they thought of, death. Go down here and hear all that the Lord our God shall say. And speak thou unto us all that the Lord our God shall speak unto thee. And we will hear it and do it. Big mistake. Big mistake. This people did not understand that even with what God spoke a little earlier, the Ten Commandments, it was so tough that they should have cried out for a savior. They should have said, how can we? We don't have the strength in us to fulfill what God expects us to fulfill. We need a savior. We need a redeemer. We need a helper. They didn't. They said, we are capable of doing what he says. You just go and hear it. Moses, come down, tell us, we'll do it. And the Lord heard the voice of your words when you spake unto me. And the Lord said unto me, I have heard the voice of the words of this people which they have spoken unto thee. They have well said all that they have spoken. Oh, that there was such a heart in them that they would fear me. God knows these fellows won't do it. And keep all my commandments always. Mark that down. That it might be well with them and with their children forever. That's the heart of God, by the way. Go say to them, get you into your tents again. But as for thee, stand thou here by me, and I will speak unto thee all the commandments and the statutes and the judgments which thou shalt teach them, that they may do them in the land which I give them to possess it. You shall observe to do, therefore, as the Lord your God commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. You shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God had commanded you, that you may live, and it will be well with you, and that you may prolong your days in the land which you shall possess. So how does long life come? By hearing from the Lord and living out what you hear from the Lord. Prolong your days. Then the most amazing thing was this. Initially, God gave every man the opportunity to hear him. These people resented it. They said, Moses, you hear, you tell us, we'll do. There is no record of any one man while he was hearing the Lord's voice falling down dead. It was utterly a terrifying sight, and yet no one fell down dead. And yet these people chose to send Moses. He said, you go, you hear, you come. Now move to chapter 8, please. So Moses stayed long enough in that place and he heard something. Underline Deuteronomy chapter 5 and verse 31. Stand thou here by me. God wants us to be by him. Wants to talk. Deuteronomy 8. All the commandments which I command thee this day shall you observe to do them, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no. So 40 years was not just punishment. I want you to mark this down. 40 years in the wilderness was to humble and to prove and to know what exactly was in their heart. So why do you go through certain things in life? Some of us don't like it, but you got to listen to it. Why do you go through a situation which waxes hot? Because God wants to see what is in your heart. How do you know what is pure gold? When the impurities fall away as the fire is heated and liquid gold begins to pour forth. How does the silversmith know that the exact temperature is reached for silver to be removed? Not when it glitters. When he sees his image on the silver, he knows the temperature is right. A little too much, it's marred. A little too little of heat, you don't get silver. It's still impure. Look at that. Highlight verse 2 in your Bible, please. 40 years to humble thee, to prove thee, to know. That means even God puts you through the grill, not because he likes it. When does meat smell real good? When it's cooking. We hear of sizzlers. People's tongue will start drooling, thinking of them. Why? Because they have gone through the cooking process. God led these people in the wilderness not to prove a point. God led them to test them and find out what was in their heart, whether they would love him and serve him. So what is humility? Not walking with bent shoulders. If that was the case, all would have crawled into the promised land. Today, how far removed we are in our land. You see a man, all he has to do is just walk around with a little bit of a stoop. Maybe even walk around in rubber slippers, that is stone. People say, what a humble man. God doesn't gauge humility that way. He is not bothered whether you dress good, look good. What he is looking at is, how does your heart look in his sight? What is on your heart? By day and by night, what is your heartbeat? What do you care for the most? What do you love the most? What will you live for? What will you die for? Look at verse 3.
And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna.
You heard what was prayed? I don't know whether you heard. That's why it's bad for you to walk in late. Good for you to come early. You will see God at work right from the time the first prayer is prayed. That's why we don't let anybody pray. We want to know who God wants to let pray.
Why did God feed them with manna?
Why did he suffer them to hunger? Not to prove that he is a God who can feed. Look,
which thou knewest not.
They didn't know what manna was earlier. Neither did thy fathers know. Abraham didn't know what manna was. Today, if you talk about manna, people think of manna sweets. That he might make thee know. That's what God wanted them to know. So he made them hunger. And then he fed them. That man doth not live by bread alone. So if you're living to eat. And eating to live. You're sadly mistaken. God doesn't want believers walking around like fools.
That he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread alone, or bread only,
but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. In fact, this is the exact words that Jesus used to combat Satan. And Satan said, turn these stones into bread. Eat. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone. He was a hunger when the tempter came. He was hungry. And Jesus lived it out all his life. Look at John 4. He was hungry. He sent his disciples, go fetch me something to eat. The woman came to the well at Samaria. He started speaking. All of a sudden, he felt rejuvenated. The disciples came. They were confused. They said, has somebody brought food before us? He was living out this verse. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That's why that prayer a little earlier. My word shall proceed and settle on the earth as dew from heaven. My doctrine will be like that. Thank God for that prayer. Hallelujah. Can I have an amen, please?
Amen. Thy raiment waxed not old upon thee, neither did thy foot swell these 40 years.
Foot swelling. Five minutes longer you stand, your foot swells. These men and women and children were on the march throughout. Raiment waxed not old. I mean, this is amazing. What do people tell you when they are giving you clothes? They'll say, don't dry it in the sun. It'll fade. The color will go off. These were people walking in the wilderness. It looked brand new. Why? Because they were dwelling in the shadow of the Most High God. El Elyon. Pillar of cloud by day. Pillar of fire by night. Right temperature. No direct heat on them. Nothing became old on them. It's amazing how they must have been walking with footwear. I had a preacher one time say it like this. He said, the shoes grew with your feet. The shoes grew with your feet. When they were walking around with size 6, it was okay for them. When their feet grew to size 10, the shoe grew simultaneously. They didn't have Chinese feet. Nobody sat and tied their feet from growing and wrapped it with string or with cloth. They just walked. They were normal. But there was no condition of lack. This is your father's house, by the way. The father's house was like this in the wilderness. Then why is it going to be something else for the church? Someone told me just the other day, very sad when I heard it. I'm having 22 pairs of slippers, but just see my feet, I'm not able to put it in, swollen. 22 pairs of slippers, but not able to wear it. Swollen feet. Look at my feet. Now look at this verse. Now I'm asking you to look at the verse. Look in your Bibles, please. It's not written on my face. It's in your word. This is what God will fulfill in your life. This is what He's going to do in your life. What did He say? Thou shalt also consider in thine heart, what? That as a man chasteneth his son, so the Lord thy God chasteneth thee. Therefore thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God to walk in his ways and to fear him. For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land. A land of brooks, of water, of fountains and depths that spring out of valleys and hills. Make a note of that, please. Not only was God asking them to have a memory, He was also asking them to have an imagination. He was giving them an image. Image. Imagination. He was painting something before their mind's eye. A panoramic view of how the promised land would be. It would be a good land, not a bad land. What would be there? Dry riverbeds? He said, it would be a land of brooks of water. They had never seen brooks of water. All that they had seen was the Nile. How will a brook be? Well, you imagine. What do you mean, Lord? How will a brook be? He said, imagine. I won't do less than your imagination. I can be less creative than you. A land of brooks of water, of fountains, and depths that spring out of valleys and hills. That means it will be such a lush place. There will be moistness in the land. Why? Moistness is connected with man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. A land of wheat, a land of barley, a land of vines, and a land of fig trees, and a land of pomegranates, and a land of olive oil, and a land of honey. A land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness. This is what the prodigal began to think about. Hallelujah! Make a note of this, please. Thou shalt not lack anything in it. A land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. So what is God talking to you about? Brass won't fall on your head. You got to dig to get there. Do I hear people this morning? Some of you become silent when you talk about work. Just the other day, I was holding some coins in my hand. A whole bunch of coins. And it was real heavy. Actually, I was supposed to go and get it changed into currency. And I put it in my pocket, and my pocket nearly broke loose from my trouser. So heavy. I had to take it out, put it back into another cover and take it to get it changed. And I was sitting here in the office, I was holding it in my hand. I said, thank God, God doesn't rain money from heaven. We'll have a lot of broken skulls. I'm not joking. Just imagine if he just rained one packet on someone's head. But people are waiting for money to fall from heaven. God didn't say it would come that way. Look at what he said. You must dig to get brass. Who must dig? God, you do, Lord. No. Not me do, Lord. You do. Thou mayest dig. So lack is connected to something. If you don't dig long enough in the right place, you're going to have lack of brass. Do I hear people this morning? Brother Hagin said something years ago that the moment I got saved, thank God I got that book. And it went into my spirit. He said that when you read the Bible, you just don't read the Bible and see what is written in the Bible. You got to see what the Bible also talks about on the flip side, the other side, which is as real as what you see written. So if you read something about the blessing, then you must know there is a flip side, cursing, where everything in reverse takes place. God talks about life. The flip side is death. Everything is in reverse. Now he's saying there is no lack in the place. But how does lack come in a man's life? When he refuses to do what he's supposed to do. He's waiting for God to do it. Now look at verse 10. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he had given thee. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping his commandments and his judgments and his statutes, which I command thee this day. That means memories of good dominate your life. Remember what Paul said in the book of Philippians. Let's go to that, please. Whatsoever things are what? Philippians chapter 4. Finally, brethren, Philippians 4:8. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, which means righteous, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely. Now look at that. What things are of a good report? Sickness is not good report. Isaiah 53 is good report. Again, I'm repeating. Sickness is not good report. Isaiah 53 is good report. Poverty is not good report. Biblical prosperity is good report. Failure is not good report. Divine success is good report. Death is not good report. Life is good report. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. So what place on your mind is important? Some people read this all their lifetime but never do anything with it. They never do anything good in life as a result of that. They are watching others overtake them. That's not God's plan. But somehow they have chosen that. That's their path. That's what they want in life. Let's read. Lest when thou wast eaten and art full. So twice this is mentioned. God wants us to eat and be full. Amen. And has built badly houses. No, I'm just asking you. Is that how your Bible reads? And has built goodly houses and dwelt therein. So you can have one home and multiple houses. No problem with God. And when thy herds and thy flocks multiply. So this is God's plan. This is God's purpose. Multiplication. Why was the unjust steward dealt with? Because he never wisely did something with his money. Even if it was one talent given into his hands, it was money as far as God was concerned. He did not do what he was supposed to do. Get an interest on it. The other two men did it. This man didn't. God said, take it away from his hand and do what? Did he say, give it to me? He said, give it to the men who knew what to do with money. If you see people who know what to do with money, you'll be surprised, but this is the truth. They will always seem to have money. It's a principle. When thy herds and thy flocks multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is depleted. Some want to look into the Bible only when I say that. Multiply. Multiplied. Why? Because God believes in increase. As people begin digging hills, not looking at hills and explaining the mountain to God, He wants them digging in and getting what He has already buried inside. Get it out! Use it! It's yours! In the process, your silver is multiplied. Your gold is multiplied. You now don't lack. You have. And all that thou hast is multiplied. then thine heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, who led thee through that great and terrible wilderness, wherein were fiery serpents and scorpions and drought, where there was no water. So we get a picture of the wilderness. We also get a picture of divine provision. A rock that followed these people everywhere they went with water. Gallons of water pouring out of a rock. I mean, it's even hard for me to dream about it. But it's biblical, because God said it happened. Biblical. Just imagine a cloud covering only one group of people. A few lakhs of people moving through the wilderness. And the people outside the wilderness standing and seeing something moving way out in the horizon. And they say, wherever these people go, that cloud is going. So we can exactly position them. Global positioning system. There. They are there. Now they moved there. You will never find a cloud in the wilderness in any other place. Divine provision. Divine protection. It was all because of one man lifting up his hands to the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. So his descendants would be blessed after him. No wonder he's called the God of Abraham. El Elyon, the Most High God. The Most High God. Most High. There were fiery serpents. There were scorpions. There was drought. There was no water. In fact, the other day when I was reading the newspaper, they have discovered a new species of spitting cobra. Very different from the spitting cobra found in that same region. In the north it's different, in the south it's different. A new species. Then you can imagine what these fiery serpents were. Somehow the serpents could not break in and knock any Israelite child. Not one lamb died because of snake bite. There was divine protection, an invisible hedge around these people. Bible says when the hedge is broken, the serpent will strike, in the book of Ecclesiastes. But somehow the hedge was not broken. It was only broken at specific times by the people, not by God. And all centered around pride and forgetfulness. Serpents, scorpions, drought, no water, who brought thee forth water out of the rock of flint. You and I know from living in India for quite some time, it takes a lot to just burst a rock and to get water from it. If you go to certain villages, you'll be able to see it more clearly. They'll use dynamite to burst the rock. The farmer doesn't look at the rock and say, water, pour forth. Nor does he go and tap at the rock once and water begins to gush forth. How did God provide the water is the most important thing. Strike the rock with your rod. Use your authority. Water began to flow. Even in the villages, it's so deep. Sometimes I've seen 3 pumps just to lift water up in different stages. 3 water pumps inserted. It's that deep they have to go to get water like that. This was not like that. This was a water that was flowing just like that. Every time people had a thirst need, it was there. And it moved when they moved. It moved when they moved. Who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, verse 16 again, which thy fathers knew not, that he might humble thee, and that he might prove thee, to do thee good at thy latter end. So it's not how you begin that matters. It's what God does in the latter end of your life that matters. Few amens. Some wanted good first. Very silent. Sometimes I can sense something rising up. Different sections of people. What's he saying? Do I have to have some more problem in my life? God wanted to do you good at your latter end. So he did what was an eternal principle. Pain first, pleasure later. You opt for pleasure first, you'll have pain later. And thou shalt say in thine heart, my power and the might of my hand hath gotten me this wealth. We heard a testimony this morning. It's not my perfection. Are we talking bad about ourselves? No. We're just giving glory where glory is due, honor where honor is due, praise where praise is due, worship where worship is due. My power, my hand hath gotten me this wealth. After all, I digged. That's why I got the brass. No. Don't forget who put the brass there in the first place. Don't forget the one who gave you revelation that behind the mounds of sand and stone lies wealth and treasure. How easily people forget. I worked. This is my money. Really? Then you see how quickly that money runs off. Then they'll come back to their senses. God, please forgive me. I spoke what I should not have spoken. Why do you have to go through that? Learn to give him the glory from day one. In all thy ways acknowledge him. We sang about it. He will direct your paths. He will direct your paths. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth. The word power literally means the authority to get wealth. So you are authorized to get wealth. Write it down. What do they say when you want to sign a check? Do they come and say, anyone can sign a check? They say, who's the authorized person? Let him sign the check. You don't go into an office and say, give me a check. And they say, Pune, come here. Sign the check and give it to him. It won't be honored. He may sign the check. When you actually go to present the check, they say, no. Check won't be honored. This is not the authorized signature of the person. Now look at it like this. You are authorized to get wealth. So when we talk about the wealth of the sinner coming into the hands of the just, we are not playing. If you think it's a play, that's your problem. But the ones who believe it and meditate on it by day and by night will begin to see God provide for them. Remember, wealth comes when you live a proper life, a biblical life, a life that is based on sowing and reaping. I heard a very thought-provoking story a little time ago. There were two men. One had a very good name in town. Why? Because he was always generous. Very good name in town. He would give everything to everybody. Please have. Please take. And there was this other man. He was a miser. He would never give to anybody. He had, but he was a miser. And he was angry with the other man who was a giver. And he was living on a different set of principles. Get, and never give. But the other man was a simple man. He was giving and giving and giving. And he never lacked really. But this man struck up a plan. He said, I'm going to destroy this man's credibility. So what did he do? One day he decided, never mind, even if I lose, I'll give this man something. But I'll do it in such a subtle way that he won't understand the snare behind what I'm going to do. So he counted 99 rupees and dropped it into the man's compound. The next day the man got up. I'm using the word rupees. The one who told this to me told it in coins. The man got up. He was surprised to see the 99 rupees. So thrilled. But then a thought came. Nobody will give 99 rupees. They must have given 100. Where is that 1 rupee? And he started searching for that 1 rupee. He forgot about his daily giving. Went on searching for the 1 rupee. Somehow he earned it and he added it. Now he said, I've got 100. When he got that 100, he forgot the days of joy that he had in giving and receiving. Now he wanted 200. Then he wanted 300. Then he wanted 400. Finally, he was no better than the miser next door. I want you to understand something. When you talk about your Christian life, your Christian life is based on biblical success, biblical principles of sowing and reaping. Not acquiring, and finally you lose the joy of simplicity that you find in living out the gospel every day. Again, I'm repeating, you may have all the money in the world, you can become a pauper overnight. How? Not because you lost your money. Because you have withered out everything good in your life by a wrong set of principles and a wrong set of living that you are adopting. No more does the needs of anybody mean anything to you. Now that's not success. I don't hear an amen, I just hear one or two amens. That is not success. That is stupidity. What is success then? Living this out. This is biblical success. Where you're trusting God and you're believing and you're working hard and you're operating on the principles of sowing and reaping, giving and receiving, seed time and harvest. And then you begin to see wealth come your way. Make a note of that, please. You're authorized to get wealth. And it shall be, if thou do at all forget the Lord thy God, and walk after other gods, and serve them. And worship them. I testify against you this day, you shall surely perish. That means you will wither away, you will decay. Nothing good will come out of your life in the long run. Why did it happen? Not because God didn't want you to prosper. It's because you started following other gods. Remember, money also is called mammon. That's why you have certain sections of people who worship money. They worship money. Some will even say work is God. No, work is not God. God is God. Work is work. Work is not God. Money is not God. But for certain sections of people, certain communities of people, money is God. They worship money. They even have names of deities who they believe will give money to them. Look at verse 19:20. As the nations which the Lord destroyed before your face, so shall you perish. Anything is written twice in the scriptures, best for you to pay note to what God says. Because you would not be obedient unto the voice of the Lord your God. So, how long should I stay in his presence? Long enough to receive a command. Do this. Don't do that. Some people think prayer is inactivity. Wrong. Prayer is activity. Because you pray, then you go about and are found faithful doing what God wants you to do every day. You look at people who are lazy, some of them run behind prayer and use prayer as an excuse for slothfulness. Prayer is never slothful. You look at any prayer warrior or prayer intercessor who did something with his life, you will never find that they were inactive people. They were very active people. They did things that have been profound in their lifetime. You read about one of the greatest intercessors of all in church history in recent times called Rhys Howells. He established the Bible school in Wales. It's an amazing life story of a man who spent time with God on an extended basis and who would yet live a life of great fruitfulness. If you get a chance to read about Rhys Howells, that book, The Intercessor, written by a man called Norman Grubb, please read it. It will transform your life. Many people believe that it was his prayers that changed the course of the destiny of Britain during World War II. That's one man's prayers. Inexplainably, there was a day when German warplanes had planned a strike on Britain and there was no response on the part of the British because they didn't have planes to respond to that kind of an attack. People were watching aghast on the radars as this huge wave of German bombers entered British airspace. They thought London would be wiped out for good. All of a sudden, please listen, this is not a story, this is reality. Every one of those planes turned back and went back to Germany. Recorded in Rhys Howells' diary was the date and the time of the exact occurrence that took place. He said, "There is a heavy burden in my spirit. And I'm praying through against this Nazi onslaught." And the minutes are ticking by. He's writing in his diary as he's standing before God. All of a sudden he says, "The burden is lifted. The victory is won. God's undertaken for his people." You're not sitting here for fun during this week of prayer. The same God of Rhys Howells is here, my friends. The same God of Elijah is here this morning. The same God of Elisha is here this morning. The same God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob is here this morning. He brought you here. He's fed you his word this morning. Now it's for you to pray. It's for you to dig the hill and get your piece of brass. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. I want you to pray for a place for this ministry. I want you to pray for a place for this ministry. Don't look at me. Just begin to pray. God's Holy Spirit is here. We are in rented property. We need a place. Whether it's going to be this place or it's going to be a new place, we need a place where we can come and worship the Lord continually. I want you to lift up your voices and pray, please. First have one desire in you, that there must be a place for God's house. Then you see how God prospers you and blesses you with something good in your life as well. I want you to pray. David said, I will not give sleep to mine eyelids, nor slumber to my body, till I see a place built for you. The reward for that was God gave him a house that would last forever. I want you to pray. I want you to pray that it will be a place that we will be able to have main services, children's worship services, office. Every need would be met. I want you to pray. I don't know where that place is, but one thing I know. The ram caught in the thicket is not just for Abraham. It's for every believer who will lift up his eyes and see God's provision on the mountaintop of the Lord. He is Jehovah Jireh. And I want you to pray a Bible prayer this morning. I don't want you begging God for anything. He doesn't want you begging either. He wants you praying the word. Pray the word. Mamariba Shatraba Sikalara Deri Anthrabo Shubala Harya. Oh Rabba Shabariba Labarimo Sikalara Deria. Labaribo Sikalara Deria. Branamo Shambra Labariba Sikalara Deria. Oh Mama Sakalara Deria. I want you to have your prayer points in your hands, please. Keep it before the Lord. You dig into the mountain or you dig into a hill to get your brass, to get something of value. You have your Bibles with you. I want you to take scripture that correlates to the prayer point you have, and I want you to pray. Children are here and they want wisdom from God. Let them turn to James chapter 1 and pray and say, God, give me wisdom. Give me wisdom. Incidentally, people think wisdom has to do only with increased understanding of studies. No, wisdom comes with two hands. One hand provides length of days. One hand provides durable riches. So in asking for wisdom, you're not asking just for understanding in mathematics or physics or English or Tamil or some other subject. No, you're asking for God Himself. You're asking for God's goodness Himself. You're asking for the very nature of God to manifest in your life. God says, I'll give of myself liberally to anyone who asks of me. Liberally! I will not upbraid. I will not give in measure. I will not give in measure. I will give liberally. Oh, Mama Shatra Bahayala, Leberibo Sikala Raderi. Brunamo Shantra Brahayala Lederibo Sikalara Deri Branama Shaprahala Boriantra. If you're waiting for the wealth of the sinner to come into the hands of the just, I want you to believe that it is something that will happen in these end times. just prior to the coming of Jesus, the church is going to see an unprecedented flow of wealth, natural wealth, coming into the hands of the believer. If you question, you doubt, you mock it, you say something in church and then go say something in your house, you're sadly mistaken. You will not get anything. Because God hears grumbling in the tents. I said, God hears grumbling in the tents. He hears murmurings in the tent. He hears your words that you speak in the recesses of your house. You can't say something in church and go say something in your house. He hears everything. You believe in wealth that God will give you. You believe it in church. You believe it in your house. You believe it when you're awake. You believe it when you sleep. You believe it at all times, in season and out of season. You may not have everything now, but if you believe, you will have someday. Pray for your prayer request. The small children sitting next to parents here who are under parental authority, lay hands on them and pray. Lay your hands on your children and pray. Remember, every blessing that you find in Deuteronomy chapter 8 has to do with Deuteronomy chapter 8. For you and for your children. For you and for your children. Lay your hands on your children. Lay your hands on your children. Don't be frightened to do it. You're not doing it to please me. You want your child blessed. You want your child prospering. You want your child in good health. You want a better future for your child. Then you better act on God's word. And bless your children. And show them that it is man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Children who are under parental authority. Parental authority. Pray for them. Mama riba shabari bala bori kabari antra. Lamaribo shatra bahala bari antra. Lakonomo sintara la raderi. E bronomo shubari bala hari antra. Kabori basika la raderia. Mama santara ba shubari bala bari antra. God is not mocked. You're sowing seed this morning. You will see a bountiful harvest come your way. If it's your dream seed that you're praying for, then pray and bless your dream seed. Give your dream seed a name. Bless your dream seed. Do it by faith. Someday you will come and say, when you made this statement, it was a dream seed, but I believed for it. Today I'm here. Mama riba shapra hala bari antra. Oh, rabba shabari balabo sikala raderia. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Today, right from the time we started, that's the emphasis. He is creator God. He is the master of all creation, protector, provider, God Almighty. He said his word will go forth and will settle the hearts of his people as the dew from heaven settles on this earth. His doctrine distills like the clearest droplets of rain. In the mighty name of Jesus, act on the word of God this morning. Act on the word of God this morning. Command the blessing. Command the blessing and write down the date. Write down the time. Write down what you did. Then you begin to see from this point on, there was a change. This area, the child was not doing well. I began to see the child prospering in that area. Cycles of sickness were broken. Mamariba shatralara deri branamo sikalara deria labariba shaboribalaba sikalara deria branamo shambralaba sikalara deri ori mamama santaralara deria. Lift up your voices and pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Spirit, please. Some of you stand as teachers before your children. Lift up your classes before the Lord this morning. Lift up your classes before the Lord this morning. Begin to pray God's blessing and prosperity over the children that you are given an opportunity to stand before. There's no use praying just before the examinations. You pray through before. I said you pray through before the examinations, the final examinations come up, or the board examinations come up. Mama riba shabari balabo sikalara deri. Branamala baribo shabari balaba sikaraba shabari balahoria. Mama ribo shantraba di raba sikobo bobo shubari balara deri. Ekamari balabaribo sikalara deria. Oh, mama sikalara deria. And if some of you are struggling with sickness or disease in your bodies, no better time than now to stand up against it. I said to stand up against it. In your spirit, stand up against the spirit of sickness. Don't be slothful when it comes to sickness. Don't be slothful when it comes to disease. Stand up against it. Don't say it's only a common cold. It's uncommon for you. I said it's uncommon for you. Stand up against it. Your nose may be running, your eyes may be watering, it doesn't matter. You may have all the symptoms of it in your body. Just stand up against it. Stand up against it. The very first step you're taking against it means you are standing up against what God hates. What God is against, you're against. What He is for, you're for. Mama ribalaba shatra brahayala. Travel sickness, sea sickness, road sickness, air sickness. Stand up against all that in the name of Jesus. It's up to you to stand up against it. If you're having growths in your body that shouldn't be there, curse it in the name of Jesus. Again, I'm repeating, growths in your body that shouldn't be around, curse it in the name of Jesus. Curse it in the name of Jesus. Hate it with all that you have. And if there's not enough hatred in you to hate sickness and disease, ask the Lord for some supernatural help this morning. I said, ask the Lord for supernatural help this morning. He hates sickness. He hates disease. He is not the author of it. He is creator of everything good. If there are growths on your body that shouldn't be there, doctors have spoken to you about it, stand up against it now in Jesus' name. Again, I'm repeating. Stand up against it now in the name of Jesus. You don't feel shy for anybody. You just speak the word of God. You stand for what God stands for. Get the victory today. Pray through today. Get the victory in your heart today. Boils will leave. Tumors will leave. Growths will leave. Warts will leave. Everything that is unclean will leave. Will leave. Will leave in Jesus' name. Problems with goiter will leave. Will leave in Jesus' name. We'll leave in Jesus' name. We'll leave in Jesus' name. Digestive problems will leave. I'm again repeating. Digestive problems will leave. The enemy you see today, you will see again no longer. In the name of Jesus. You will see no longer. Mama riba shaprahala bari antra. Mama ribo shabari bala bari basikala raderia. Brana malaba shaboria. Radoro sikala raderi. Digestive orders, disorders will leave in Jesus' name. Problems with acidity will leave in Jesus' name. Acute constipation will leave in the name of Jesus. Will leave in the name of Jesus. Will leave in Jesus' name. Related problems will be healed as well. I said related problems will be healed as well. I'm not speaking from my natural mind. The natural mind doesn't understand the things of God. But the spiritual man understands the things of God. Because they're spiritually discerned. I don't let the natural man stand and say this and this will be healed. The spirit man is receiving revelation from God. And as he receives, he speaks. I'm just giving mouth to the words that I hear. Related problems will be healed. Mama shatrala raderia amranoho sikala raderia. Problems with piles, anything at all. Fistulas. They will leave in Jesus' name. They will leave in Jesus' name. And you will testify of the healing of the Lord. I said you will testify about the healing of the Lord. You will testify. The God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob is also the one whom you call Jehovah Rapha. The Lord your physician. The Lord your physician. The Lord your physician. Hallelujah. 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 Let's bow our heads in a moment of prayer. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. So grateful for this day and the privilege we have had to be in your presence. What a joy it's been to just spend time in your presence, to stay long enough to hear from you, to stay long enough to receive words of not just encouragement, direction, comfort, guidance, counsel. But to also hear specific words from you that the Spirit of God speaks into our hearts. We believe, O Father, every single word that you have spoken will stand. And you'll confirm the word with signs and wonders following. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Protect your people under the blood. Adults, children, single individuals, families, people from different backgrounds. Oh Lord, I pray in Jesus' mighty name that you will fulfill your word to them. Specific words will be fulfilled as well. General directives will be fulfilled as well, because they stem from your word. Protect your people as they go back even now under the blood. Let your hedge be strong about them. Make it up to them. The time that they've spent here, O Father, guide them right through this day. With your blessing, let them go even now. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, Amen and Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go with the peace of God. And remember, God loves you real good. Don't forget, we will have the week of prayer again extended tomorrow. And I want you to come pray through. Take time, even before you come here, to spend a few moments to gather your thoughts, to believe that God will speak to you and give you direction and show you what He wants you to have and experience in your life. God bless you.